Have you ever looked up at the night sky and wondered not just what's out there, but whether we'll ever live there? Not just a few astronauts orbiting Earth for a few months, not space tourism for billionaires, but entire civilizations. Children born on the moon, families growing food on Mars, universities floating above Venus. It might sound like science fiction, but we're getting closer than you think. In fact, space colonization is no longer a distant dream. It's the next chapter of human evolution. And in this video, we're going to explore that future. We'll go beyond the headlines, beyond the hype, and look at the real science, the real plans, and the real possibilities. Because if humanity is to survive the next 1,000 years or the next million, we can't stay on Earth forever. We'll travel to the moon, Mars, the floating cities of Venus, the icy moons of the outer solar system, and even to massive space stations built in orbit. We'll talk about the challenges, the ethics, the economics, and we'll ask, where will the next generation of humans actually live? Stay with me to the end, because what you're about to hear may change the way you see our place in the universe forever. Let's be honest, Earth is amazing. It's our cradle. The only place in the universe where we know life exists. Lush, diverse, rich in history and culture and color. We've built wonders here, dreamed big, and reached for the stars. But Earth isn't eternal, and more importantly, it's fragile. Our climate is destabilizing. We're watching the polar ice melt, the oceans rise, and the air heat up. Fires rage, crops fail, ecosystems collapse. Over 8 billion people are sharing a planet that's struggling to support them all. And that's just the short-term view. In the long run, Earth is doomed. Not tomorrow, not in our lifetime, but eventually. The sun is aging. In about a billion years, it will burn so hot it will boil Earth's oceans. In 5 billion, it will swell into a red giant and consume this planet entirely. That may sound like a distant problem, but the lesson is clear. No matter how beautiful Earth is, we can't stay here forever. We need a plan B. Some say we should focus on fixing Earth instead of escaping it. And they're right. We must fix Earth. But it's not either or. It's both. We have the power to walk and chew gum at the same time, to preserve our home while preparing for a future where humans live across many worlds, not just one. Because if all of humanity exists in one fragile place, then one disaster, natural or man-made, could end it all. But if we spread out, if we colonize the stars, then nothing can stop us. Our journey starts just 3 days away. The moon. It's the closest celestial body to Earth. We've been there before. 12 humans have walked on its surface, but not since 1972. That's changing. NASA's Artemis program is preparing to return to the moon. And not just for a visit. The goal is to build a permanent presence. Why the moon? It's a natural testing ground. We can simulate life on other planets, experiment with technology, and learn how to live off Earth. At the moon's south pole, hidden in permanently shadowed craters, scientists have found frozen water ice. That's a game changer. Water means life. Water can be split into oxygen for breathing and hydrogen for fuel. It turns the moon from a barren rock into a refueling station, a farming zone, a home. Imagine a network of lunar bases connected by pressurized tunnels, solar panels stretching across this gray surface. Astronauts walking in exosuits, tending to algae farms, printing tools with lunar glagolith. Imagine Earth rise from your window every night. It won't be easy. Radiation is intense. Dust is oppressive. Temperatures swing from 120 degrees to minus 130 degrees. But every problem on the moon is a chance to solve a bigger problem on Mars. That's why the moon matters. it's our laboratory, our proving ground, or maybe one day our second home. Now let's go further, past the Earth, past the Moon, through the asteroid belt, to the red planet, Mars. For decades, Mars has been the dream, the ultimate frontier. Cold, dry, and deadly, but also promising. Mars is Earth's little brother. Smaller, yes, but familiar. It has seasons, ice caps, dust storms, ancient riverbeds. We've sent dozens of missions. Landers, orbiters, rovers. We've mapped its surface, sniffed its soil, and drilled into its crust. We found evidence of ancient water, and maybe even microbial life. And now we want to go. SpaceX is building Starship, an enormous, reusable rocket that could carry 100 people to Mars at once. NASA's working on the Mars sample return mission. China and the UAE had their eyes on the red planet too. But living there, that's a different story. Mars is cold. Born chilling cold. Average temperature, minus 63 degrees. Its atmosphere is 100 times thinner than Earth's, and it's almost pure carbon dioxide. The gravity is just 38% of Earth's. That might mess with your muscles, your bones, and even your brain. And radiation, without a magnetic field or thick atmosphere, the surface is bombarded with cosmic rays. But it's not impossible. Colonies could live in underground lava tubes, protected from radiations. They could grow food in pressurized greenhouses, recycle every drop of water, generate power from the sun. They'd need new laws, new governments, maybe even new languages. Life on Mars wouldn't be Earth too. It would be its own civilization. But think about it. For the first time in human history, we'll have a second branch of our species, a backup, a bold new beginning, and maybe one day, the birthplace of the first true Martians. If Mars is our most likely planetary neighbor to host life, Venus is its cautionary tale. Slightly smaller than Earth, Venus was once thought to be our twin, but over time, it turned into a furnace. The surface pressure on Venus is like being a kilometer beneath Earth's ocean. The atmosphere is 96% carbon dioxide. It rains sulfuric acid. The heat melts lead. Yet above the surface, in the high atmosphere, there is an oasis of possibility. Roughly 50 kilometers above the Venusian surface, temperatures are surprisingly mild. The pressure is similar to that on Earth. And in this zone, an altitude band suspended above the inferno, scientists envision floating cities. These are not fantasy sketches. NASA's high-altitude Venus operational concept, or HAVOC, outlines human habitats that could float like balloons in the Venusian atmosphere, powered by solar energy, crewed by explorers, shielded from radiation by the thick atmosphere below. Life here wouldn't be like on Mars. You wouldn't walk on the surface. You'd live suspended in the skies. There would be no farming on the ground. Instead, you'd cultivate food in pressurized environments. You'd drink recycled water. You'd look out across a planet of fire, from the safety of the clouds. Venus is a warning, and maybe a second chance. A place where we learn not just how to survive, but how not to destroy a world. Let's venture even farther now, past the asteroid belt, past Jupiter and Saturn, into the deep cold of the outer solar system. Out here, far from the warmth of the sun, things get strange, but also promising. Titan, Saturn's largest moon, is bigger than Mercury. It has a thick orange atmosphere, denser than Earth's, and it's the only moon in the solar system known to have lakes and rivers on its surface. But these aren't water lakes. They're made of methane and ethane, liquid hydrocarbons. At minus 180 degrees, it's an alien world for sure. But it's also one of the most Earth-like environments we've discovered. Beneath Titan's icy crust lies an ocean of liquid water, a hidden world. And where there's water, there's potential for life. NASA's Dragonfly mission, set to launch in the 2030s, will send a rotorcraft to hop between Titan's surface locations and an unprecedented kind of exploration. And then there's Europa, a moon of Jupiter. Its surface is a solid crust of ice, but underneath is a deep global ocean. Scientists estimate it might hold more water than all of Earth's oceans combined. That ocean is heated by tidal flexing, gravitational squeezing from Jupiter. Heat and water together make Europa one of the top candidates for life beyond Earth. Enceladus, another icy moon of Saturn, has already spayed water vapor to space through geysers at its south pole. We've flown spacecraft through them. Imagine future missions, robotic submarines diving beneath the ice, exploring alien oceans, and one day, perhaps humans living above in insulated domes, tapping into heat sources, creating sustainable micro-civilizations far from the sun. Cold? Yes. But these icy moons offer the potential for something we're all searching for. A second Genesis, a second Earth under ice. But what if colonizing planets isn't the answer at all? What if the future of humanity isn't on other worlds, but in worlds we build ourselves? That's the vision behind artificial habitats, massive space stations capable of housing thousands or even millions of people, complete ecosystems in orbit with gravity generated by rotating sunlight filtered through mirrors, and cities built on the inner walls of enormous cylinders. The concept isn't new. In the 1970s, physicist Gerard K. O'Neill proposed enormous space habitats, now known as O'Neill cylinders, each several kilometers long. Inside them, people would walk on curved landscapes. Trains would run along the axis. Forests would bloom beneath simulated skies. These structures would rotate to create artificial gravity. Solar mirrors would provide day and night cycles. With enough engineering, they could support full-scale agriculture, water systems, and even weather. Today, companies like Blue Orange are revisiting these ideas. Jeff Bezos has said he envisions millions of people living in space. And instead of terraforming distant planets, he suggests we move heavy industry off Earth, preserving our home planet as a garden world while humanity thrives in space. Such megastructures could orbit Earth, the Moon, or the Sun. They could be built from materials mined from asteroids or the Moon. They'd be clean, controlled, sustainable, and endlessly expandable. It may sound ambitious, but consider this. Everything needed to build them exists today. The only thing missing is the will. And beyond all that, beyond the Moon, Mars, Venus, and even the icy moons, lies the vast dark sea between the stars, interstellar space. It's not something we're ready for yet. The distances are enormous. The challenge is almost incomprehensible, but the dream is alive. Proxima Centauri, the closest star system, is just over 4 light years away. And it has an Earth-sized planet, Proxima b, that orbits within the habitable zone. It's cold, yes, bathed in solar flares, but it's a start. Scientists are already working on breakthrough propulsion concepts, light sails that ride on lasers, fusion engines, antimatter drives. generation ships that carry entire communities on journeys that last centuries. Some dream of cryogenic sleep. Others of digital immortality, uploading consciousness and sending it across space as information. It sounds like science fiction, but then again, so did airplanes. So did spaceflight. So did walking on the moon. If we survive the coming centuries, if we master energy and keep our civilization stable, then the stars aren't unreachable. They're inevitable. So now, after all this, after moons and Mars, clouds and oceans, cylinders and stars, ask yourself, where will we go? Where should we go? Should we build cloud cities above Venus? Or dig tunnels beneath the Martian soil? Should we float in space? Or dive beneath Europa's ice? Or should we stay home and simply preserve the blue dot we begin on? The truth is, the future of space colonization isn't just about technology. It's about who we want to be, what values we carry into space, what kind of civilizations we build, not just where, but how. One day, children may be born who have never seen Earth, who've only known the skies of Mars, the clouds of Venus, or the stars through the dome of a cylinder. Will they know where they came from? Will they look back at Earth the way we now look up at the moon? And what will this say about us, about the generation that looked beyond Earth and said, let's go? Thanks for watching. If this journey inspired you, subscribe to Orbital Vistas. Give this video a like and tell me in the comments, where would you choose to live in space? Until next time, keep looking up, because the future isn't just out there, it's already beginning.